Hi, friends, and welcome to our latest edition of Keeping Up with the Jackrabbits. I'm Tyler Merriam. It is hard to believe we are almost to the month of September, but here we are. And we should be talking about the beginning of the soccer season, but unfortunately we are not. However, we are talking with the head coach of Jackrabbit Soccer, Brock Thompson. Always good to see you, my friend, even if it's over Zoom.
It's great to be with you, Tyler, and I look forward to doing it in person, hopefully at some point soon, but this will suffice.
It is remarkable how much you and I really wish we'd see each other's faces in person. We never thought we'd say that, did we?
That's a true statement, but I guess you don't know what you miss until you actually go without it.
All right, we talked a few months ago on this podcast. By the way, you are the first repeat offender on Keeping Up with the Jackrabbits, so we should acknowledge that. Congratulations on that honor, Brock. But nevertheless, we talked about just how your team was handling things, how you were keeping up with all the members of your squad at that point in time. Now, of course, they're all back on campus, supposed to be in season already, but unfortunately that hasn't occurred. So as all this news broke and the Summit League made its decision to first not have non-conference, then not have conference during the fall, how have your student athletes handled that news?
Yeah, there's been a lot to it. And, you know, I would sum it up by saying our players have been fantastic and what they've dealt with and the uncertainty and the anxiety, they've handled it really, really, really well. And I've been super impressed with them. We came back on August 3rd to start our preseason and just a short time after that, the season was officially postponed. I give a ton of credit to Justin Sell and Barry Dunn and Kathy Halens. They addressed our team face-to-face really the next morning after that news broke. And our players really, you know, they really didn't miss a beat. And I think that part of it is our program is founded really on relationships. And even though we're not playing this fall, we're still building relationships with each other. They're still teammates. They're still there for each other. One of the big kind of cornerstones of our program is we compete with each other to win championships. And so there's a sense of unity in our mission, and our players have just kind of always bought into that. It's never been about competing against their teammate for playing time. It's always been about competing with each other, and they've stuck together remarkably well. They've faced a ton of challenges and more challenges once the general student body came back, just with different protocols and classes look different, and the changes that they are having to navigate on a daily and weekly basis is great. But they're doing a really good job, and I'm just grateful for good leadership. I'm grateful for a great staff, and we've got three really good captains that are helping kind of steady the ship from a peer leadership standpoint.
I wanted to ask about that. How important during these times, you obviously and your staff can say things, you can have President Dunn, you can have Justin Sell, but to have seniors and to have captains that can really be leaders through difficult times, when you have good leaders, that makes such a difference. I have to imagine that's the case during this situation as well.
Yeah, and it's kind of a unique story. I mean, we've traditionally been a one-captain program, you know, and then have a leadership council that supports that captain. But we decided to go with three because we had three unique individuals with different strengths and felt like we could utilize them in the right way. And it's been a real blessing because it would be monumental in a certain way to have one captain that kind of is at the front of the ship from a peer leadership standpoint. So Marissa, Katie, and Adelaide are doing a great job, and it's challenging for them, but I think that they're all different. Their relationships and connections essentially kind of spiderweb out at different layers, and it's helped us a ton. It's vital to have peer leadership during this time.
How much are you seeing the girls right now?
Yeah, so we see them about every day, minus the weekends. We're kind of in essentially what is like February and March mode. Is kind of what we're in. And so what does that mean? It means they lift three times a week and we do four soccer sessions a week. Now the soccer session, there's a number of restrictions as far as social distancing, and we're not allowed to play or have any contact. And so it's been challenging from a coaching standpoint. It's been, we've had to be really creative, and I've always felt like anytime things are limited, innovation is at a premium. And so, there's a part of me that's really enjoyed having to just dissect how to teach technique and dissect parts of the game at a much more specific level than we've ever had to, because we've just skipped over into more of a tactical approach to the game. And there's an element of it that's been fun, but it's also, I know we're all chomping at the bit to play, even if it's against each other sometimes.
Soccer is a sport that has always played some in the spring. And so to have a spring schedule is not completely out of left field, but this will certainly be different than it normally is. How do you view this of a spring and a fall? Or because soccer is typically a year-round sport for so many kids, is that really that big of an issue, you think?
I don't think it's a super big issue. I think that I don't expect that we're going to play a 20-game schedule in the spring. I think it's going to be a modified schedule. I think that we'll have somewhere there's been a few scheduling models that have popped out even different than what's ever happened in a soccer schedule. They're talking about playing, you know, if we go to Oral Roberts, instead of going to Oral Roberts for one game, playing the same team Friday, Sunday. So it just involves one location, sure. Two teams, no travel in between, no other teams on the weekend, just from a trying to minimize the amount of exposure if something does happen with the pandemic. So there's a lot of differences, but just playing a conference schedule, but playing everybody in the conference twice, but at one site. So a little bit more of like a baseball, softball, single round robin model is kind of where things seem to be headed. And so that gets us, you know, that gets us essentially to 16 games, you know, starting at some point in March is kind of what's being talked about at the conference level. And there's still a lot to be worked out as far as what's the NCAA tournament going to look like? Is it, I don't believe it will be 64 teams. Well, you know, is it just all at large teams? Is it all automatic teams? Mm-hmm. I'm following the advice that I give my players and just, you know, all we can do is react to any information that we have. And there's three real entities that are going to make decisions that are going to impact our program, South Dakota State University, you know, the Summit League and the NCAA. And we can lose a lot of sleep and we can worry a ton if we start to read different social media platforms and things like that. And so I'm just grateful to be around my team. Every day we get together is a huge blessing for us.
What's been your biggest challenge through all of this?
Just the constant change. You know, normally we would give our players a schedule for the fall semester. From August 3rd until finals is normally the schedule that we would give them. And it feels like if we give them a schedule for the next week, I don't believe we've gotten through a week without having some sort of a modification to that schedule. And so that's just it's a challenge for everybody. And I think different players on our team, it's a greater challenge for. We've got some players that are extremely organized. You're much more organized than I am, and it drives them even crazier than it drives me. But that's the biggest challenge. It's really day by day, but you try to plan it at least week by week for the student athletes' well-being.
What have you learned from your team during this whole process?
Yeah, I've learned. It's reinforced that listen, we all love soccer, but we love each other more. And I think we all kind of knew that, but I think it's just reinforced that. It really is. It's less about the game and it's more about the people you're in the project with. And I'm grateful for Kaylee and Andy and certainly, you know, Ben and Andre and Andrew and I'm grateful for our players, but I think our players would echo that. They love to play, but they love each other more than they love the game. And I think this time has reinforced that much, much more.
Brock, appreciate you joining us for a few minutes here to share what's going on with Jackrabbit Soccer, and certainly hope that we can turn the corner on all this and get to see plenty of soccer coming up here in just a few months.
Sure. I'm actually looking forward to having the weather get better as our season goes along instead of having to pack warmer and warmer clothes as the season wears on. So that'll be an adjustment for me.
Will it ever be short sleeve weather, though, for a home soccer game?
Never say never. You know, it might be short sleeve weather for the first half and parka weather for the second half.
Brock, thank you.
Thanks, Tyler. Really appreciate it.
He's Brock Thompson. I'm Tyler Merriam. Thanks for joining us on Keeping Up with the Jackrabbits.